Hey, this is Denver Riddle with Color Grading Central, and this is a 20-minute crash course on color grading in DaVinci Resolve 15. You'll learn how to use it, you'll learn the tools, and together we'll create this really amazing look that you can download as a LUT or lookup table so you can easily create this same look on your own footage. Also, I want to let you know about a free live training event I'll be doing. I'll be sharing with you my top color grading secrets. You can ask me questions. It's free to attend. Details are below this video in the description. All right, let's do this thing. DaVinci Resolve is divided into six pages following a left-to-right workflow, where we import footage in the media page, assemble our edit in the edit page, work on VFX or graphics in the fusion page, do our color grading in the color page, design and mix our audio in the Fairlight page, and finally, export our project from the Deliver page. It's just that simple. The Media page is where we can preview clips by double-clicking on them and import them into the project by dragging them into the media pool. I'm just going to import a few pre-trimmed clips, and once they're in the media pool, we'll go to the Edit page and create a new timeline by going to File, then New Timeline. We'll give it a name, and then click Create. This will create a new timeline, and we'll drag those clips into the timeline. Now we can make any editorial changes if we like. Resolve is an editing program after all, and once our edit is looking the way we like it, we're now ready for our color grading. Now, because our primary focus is going to be on color grading, we'll just briefly touch on the Fusion page so you can at least know that it's there. In the Fusion page, we have the Notes section with an input and an output. The input is for our original image coming in, and the output is for our image going out. In between is where we can do VFX and compositing. So let's say, for instance, we want to add a blur effect over our talent's face. We'll go to the Effect library, choose Blur Effect, and this will be added to the node tree. We'll then go to the inspector and increase the blur value. But you'll see, however, that this affects the entire image, so we'll need to add a mask. Going back to the Effects library, I'll choose Mask and Ellipse. A node representing the mask is added to the node tree as a property of the blur effect, and we can position and resize the mask on the viewer or use the options in the Inspector tab. We can also use a Merge node to merge multiple effects over the same image too, and this allows us to do tracking, 3D compositing, all kinds of stuff. Now, for most people, they won't need to use the Fusion page, but it is here for VFX artists and finishers. All right, let's go ahead and delete this blur effect, and let's jump to the color page. At the top, we have the viewer, the nodal tree, where we keep track of our corrections. In the middle section, we have all the clips in our project represented as thumbnails. And the bottom section is where we have our color tools. Now, before we jump in and start grading this thing, let's discuss basic terminology for how we define color. The three basic terms we use to define color are hue, saturation, and luma. Hue is the name we call colors, saturation is the intensity or vividness of a hue, and luma is the brightness or shade of hue. It's also important to know how to read the video scopes, which can be super beneficial. We'll bring up the scopes by right-clicking on the viewer and selecting Show Scopes. The two scopes I always use are the waveform and color overlay mode and the vector scope with the flesh line turned on. The waveform lets us correct for exposure, and with the color overlay mode turned on, unchecking the Y, it allows us to correct for white bounce issues when the color channels line up evenly. If I overlay an image on top of the waveform, you can see that the trace, the stuff you see here, actually corresponds with the image of the guy walking when I play this back. The vector scope corresponds directly with the color wheel, and I've overlaid it here for convenience. It shows us what colors are in the image as well as their saturation. The further the trace extends from the center of the scope, the more saturated or vivid the colors are. Here's a simple but powerful workflow for color correction. We first correct the exposure or brightness of the image, second, the white balance or color temperature if there are any issues, and lastly, the saturation by either increasing or reducing it. This will make more sense as we actually do it. I'll choose this clip as our hero shot. Let's first make a correction to the exposure of this image using the primary color wheels. The horizontal wheels adjust the exposure, and the pucks in the middle of the color wheels adjust the color. The lift mostly adjusts for the shadows or the darkest parts of the image, the gain for the highlights or brightest parts of the image, and the gamma for the midtones or everything else in between. The fourth wheel is the offset control, which adjusts the entire image, and there are some instances where you'd use it. Now looking at this, it's really flat. This is very common to see when you capture in a log or flat profile. So how we'll correct the shot is we'll adjust the shadows first with the lift control while watching the waveform. We want to bring the trace and the shadows down until the darkest parts of the image sit right above zero. Then we'll bring up the highlights so the brightest parts of the trace sits right about here near the top. Then we'll bring the midtones down by pulling down on the gamma slider. This gives us good contrast and exposure. Next, we'll need to fix the color temperature since our image seems to be a little too warm or reddish. We can clearly see the red trace dominating the middle and top of our waveform. Our goal is to neutralize or white balance the whites, so the way to do that is to first find something in the image that is white. In this case, we can use the gal's white shirt and its corresponding trace in the waveform. Our goal is to get the color channels to align evenly, and when they do, the trace will turn white, indicating that we've achieved white balance. A quick and easy way to do this is with the white balance eyedropper found under the lift wheel. Keep an eye over on the trace as I click on the white shirt. And voila! The trace for the highlights is now white, indicating we've achieved white balance. And just in case you're not happy with the results, or if you think the whites look too sterile or clinical, we can manually adjust this using the temperature and tint sliders found under the number 2. Lastly, let's boost the color a little bit by increasing the saturation. Here's what the clip looked like before and after the correction. Doesn't that look awesome? If it does, go ahead and give this video a like. All right, now that our hero shot is color corrected, let's move on. On the next shot, we'll repeat the procedure, going for a nice balance of exposure with the lift, gamma, and gain controls. The color temperature in the shot looks off too, so we'll use the white balance eyedropper again, this time using the white wall. Lastly, we'll add some saturation too. Moving to the next shot, we want to match it to the first shot for obvious reasons, since this is just a tighter version of the hero shot. To give us a good starting point, let's copy the correction from the first clip to this one. To do that, we'll go to the first clip, open up the gallery, right-click on the viewer, and select Grab Still. What this does is it adds a still to the gallery, saving our correction so we can use it later on. Now coming back to this clip, we'll right-click on the still in the gallery, and select Apply Grade. And bada bing, bada bang. That gives us a good starting point, but you'll see that we do have some matching issues. To help us with matching these shots, let me just share with you my preferred method for doing this. We'll turn on the split screen view and change the dropdown to Selected Clips. If we now Command or Control click if you're on Windows on shot 1, we can now see the images side by side. We can also see them side by side in the waveform scope, which makes matching a breeze. To match the traces better, we'll bring the shadows, midtones, and highlights up with the offset control. Then to improve the color match, we'll drag the tint to the left and the temperature to the right to warm it up. That's a nice looking match. In the interest of time, I've already gone ahead and performed color correction to these remaining clips. But in this next shot, you'll see that the bricks on this building in the background are looking too yellow when I think they should be more reddish or orange in color. To fix this, we'll create a new node, and we'll use one of my favorite tools to do quick secondary fixes, and that's with the hue versus hue curve, where we'll place 2 points on the color spectrum to isolate the yellows, then add a center point, and drag up a little bit to lean those yellow hues more towards red. Now, if I disable and enable this node, you'll notice that this correction also affects the yellow painted lines on the asphalt. We don't want that. So a cool ninja trick I want to show you is we can further qualify or isolate our correction with a power window. Going to the Windows panel, we'll turn on a curve window and draw a shape mask around the building. Then we'll add some softening or feathering to the edges so the window isn't so apparent. And voila! Our correction now only affects the building. But you'll see that when we play the clip back, the camera moves, making our power window move out of place. So we want to address that. Going to the tracker panel, we can easily and effortlessly track the shape by clicking on the track forward button. Isn't that awesome? This is one of the things that I absolutely love about DaVinci Resolve. Now we've completed our basic color correction for all five shots, but let's say that for whatever reason, our client decides that they don't like the girl's red sneakers in our first shot. Instead, they want them to be, say, purple in color. Well, the cool thing is we can fix it in post with the HSL Qualifier tool. To do that, we'll need to add a new node, and then going to the Qualifier panel, and with the eyedropper tool, we'll drag through the red sneakers to isolate them. To see what we've selected, we'll turn on the highlight feature, the magic wand you see here. To refine our key, we'll change the width and center of our hue selection, and pull the saturation low to the right. We'll further clean up the key with the matte finesse tools. Okay, now let's turn the highlight feature off and drag the hue control to the right until the sneakers turn a purple color. Yes, isn't that so cool? Now, keep in mind, this isn't the only shot where we see the red sneakers, so we'll want to copy this correction to the other shot of her dancing. But before we do that, let me show you something really cool. If we right-click on the node, we have an option to choose Save as Shared Node. You'll see that it now gets labeled as Shared Node 1. Now when I go to copy this correction to any other clip, and say I now want to change the color of the sneakers to, say, green, I can right-click on this node, turn off the Lock Node option, make the change, and because it's a shared node, it's automatically updated on the other shots that have the same shared node. Pretty cool, right? Okay, now we're to the really fun part, and that's creating an awesome look for these clips. I'm going to show you a quick way to apply the same look on top of all these clips, and this will save you a ton of time and ensure that you have a consistent look across the board. You're welcome. Okay, to do that, we'll select all the clips in the timeline using the Shift key to select a row. Then right-click and choose the option Add into New Group. We'll give it a name. We'll call this Orange Teal Look since that's the look we're going for. Then click OK. Then we'll change this dropdown from Clip to Group Post Clip. What this simply means is that when we want to make a change, it's applied to all the clips in the group. All right, now let's create the look. The Orange Teal Look is a really popular look because it uses principles of color contrast to make the skin tones or our talent stand out from the background. And frankly, it just looks awesome, so you're gonna love this. In the first node, let's dial up the contrast for our look. To stay organized, we'll right-click on the node and choose Node Label. In this case, I'll just call this Contrast. For this part of the look, we'll use the custom curves, which allow us to make complex adjustments to the exposure. Now, just a quick crash course on the way this works, the bottom point adjusts the shadows, the top point adjusts the highlights, and we can make as many points along the curve in between to fine-tune the contrast. In this case, we don't want to affect the highlights or the shadows too much, so we'll create contrast in between these areas known as the undertones and midtones. I'll make a point here in the midtones and drag up. This improves our exposure, but it makes the undertones look a little washed out. So let's add another point here and drag it down to adjust the density of the undertones. There, that looks nice. Now we have much richer contrast. For color, let's add another node and name it Teal. Here we'll push teal colors into the overall image with the offset control. This is where we'll start to see that color contrast. Next, we'll add a parallel node or a color adjustment at this same stage in the grade, and we'll bring out the skin tones. We'll just label this node Skin Tones. Now, this is where we'll get them to pop. Going to the hue versus sat curve and using the eyedropper tool, we'll click on the skin tones to auto set the points on the curve. Then dragging up on the center point, we can make the skin tones pop without affecting anything else. We'll then just refine the curve to make sure that all the warm colors in the skin are saturated evenly. Lastly, because we pushed teal into the entire tonal range with the offset control, it's making our shadows also look teal. So we'll want to clean them up so that we can have clean shadows. To do that, I'm going to show you a really awesome trick. we'll add another node, call it clean shadows, and go to the Lumaverse sat curve. Now, the way this tool works is the shadows are to the left and the highlights are to the right. And then anywhere that we place points on the curve, we can affect the saturation for that part of the tonal range by either pulling up to increase the saturation or pull down to decrease it. So this is a really cool way for selectively reducing the saturation in the shadows without affecting anything else. So we'll place a point here so that nothing above is affected, and then we'll drag the left point all the way down to reduce the saturation in the shadows. I'll then just adjust this a little bit more, and voila, our shadows are nice and clean. If I toggle this node off and on again a few times, you can see the difference it made in pulling the teal out of the shadows on the side of this blue car, as well as in the dark metal on the windows. Okay, so don't forget that cool trick. As a final touch, I want to apply one of the free LUTs from Ascend that you can download when you sign up for the free online workshop. I want to show you how we can actually preview LUTs in real time in DaVinci with the LUT browser, and this is totally amazing that we can do this. We didn't always have this ability. At the top left of our screen, we'll find the LUT browser option. Let's go ahead and click on it, and now we have a list of all of our LUTs. Now, this is also the same as if you'd right-clicked on a node to view the LUTs, but the big difference is that we can have a visual preview of the LUT before we apply it, and this makes finding the right LUT for your project so much easier. I'll navigate to the Ascend LUTs, and hovering the cursor over the LUT thumbnails, you'll see a real-time preview of each LUT in the viewer. We'll choose a three-strip LUT by double-clicking on it. Ugh. That's too strong, but that's okay because we can dial it back to taste by going to the key panel and pulling back on the output gain control until we have a result that we're happy with. Now let's play this whole thing back. What an amazing look. All right, to wrap this all up, I'll jump to the Fairlight page. Although we've been primarily focused on the color grading, I think it's worth pointing out that the Fairlight page gives us professional audio tools that you'd normally only find in high-end TV and film production tools. So that's really amazing that we've been given so much. So let's just explore it briefly. Here we have access to the media pool. We have the effects library, which will list any VST audio plugins that you have on your system. The index section, which displays the track list and markers. We have the timeline and transport controls. A mixer, meters, metadata section, an inspector to see the characteristics of any audio clip, and pretty much anything else that you'd need to make a really sweet audio mix. In my particular case, I don't have any audio associated with these clips, so we can just jump to the deliver page, but I want you to see that this is all in here. Now, the deliver page has four sections: the render settings, the viewer, the timeline, and the render queue, where we basically press go. For this project, we'll output for uploading to YouTube so we can choose from one of the convenient presets. We can change the output resolution to 1080p, specify a location for exporting, and finally click Add to Render Queue, then start render. It's as easy as that. Now, I know I went through a lot and I skipped over a lot of details, but what I wanted to give to you is the big picture. And if you like this tutorial and you'd like to see more and download the free LUTs I mentioned, then sign up for my free online training at the link below. At the event, I'll share with you my top color grading secrets. You can ask me questions. So to reserve your seat, visit the link below, and I promise you it'll be well worth your time and you'll get a lot better from one simple 1 hour training. So I hope that you enjoyed this crash course as much as I enjoyed creating it for you, and I look forward to seeing you on the webinar. Have a great day.